All right, hello everybody, and welcome to the EGF Rival Series Texas Region. Today's matchup, we have UT Permian Basin against UT Austin, which looking to be some good stuff. Today we have me, Sandman, and my co-caster.
And it's straight ripping here.
All right, and we're really looking forward to some matches today. And Kings Row to start off is, you know, the very standard pick. I think a comfort pick for pretty much everybody. The map rotation we have today, we have Kings Row, Eichenwald, and Route 66. So we are going to see Eichenwald, which I rarely ever see, like ever, because I don't think anyone really likes it.
I think it'll be really fun in order to see the teams and what they're able to pull off if they're able to utilize some strategies going over the sides of the map, you know, maybe over the buildings, possibly around the big tower or whatever that would be. It's always just fun to see the strong sieges coming out. I really enjoy it personally anyways.
Yeah, I'm not a huge fan of playing it. I actually just played a match today on it. It was cancerous. We had two overtimes. It was horrible. But looks like today, triple support out of Permian Basin here. That's interesting.
Remember that time and we stole the crown,
also a Junkrat. Very interesting choices here. Double tank, which is fairly standard, but everything else is a little mixed up here. And I think they're trolling us just a little bit inside of UT Austin. No tanks. We just have a whole bunch of DPS with a Sombra, Hanzo. And no healers.
So I actually like this coming out from UT if they're able to make it work for right now. If they're able to get a pick or two and actually make it useful, which looks like the Widowmaker getting a couple of hits in there, it can actually swing heavily in your favor. There goes the actual Junkrat right now. We got a pull coming down. UT Austin looks like that they're going to make this work in their favor. They just have to push on up now.
It is definitely working in their favor. It looks like Sombra's going to go down, but so far they have the advantage, but they don't have a lot of pushing power right now.
And we're finally seeing, somebody from the Reinhardt goes down for UT right here, and looks like the Permian Basin's coming back with this a little bit. They're pushing back in a little bit here. Roadhog's coming up, but I don't think that he's going to be able to contest it himself. The way that they were picked off at the very beginning kind of set this up for UT to be able to come in here and take this for themselves.
There's a problem though. They're kind of just getting off the point. They're like dancing around it. I don't know if they're a bit more focused on the defense rather than actually, you know, defending their position rather than actually taking the point. They are able to take and go away with it, but that could have been done way faster.
Sure. I as mentioned, I personally thought that the strategy was very interesting, but you've seen this by a couple of teams if they're mechanically good enough to pull it off. As we see here, some of the flankers going pretty deep here, the Sombra getting two kills and then some pits off from the Hanzo. The Sombra is actually going pretty hard right here, but there's nobody on the point.
I don't know if they really care. They're just kind of doing whatever they want to do.
I wonder if they're just throwing some style points out there for themselves, just to send a message of some kind, maybe.
Yeah, that's. I can't imagine, or I can't think of any other reason they would just leave the payload like that. I mean, they're going very, very aggressive here, and they're not making them pay for it. You'd think they would, especially with the only two up front at the time were the snipers. And I was just. I don't even know what to say to that right now.
So I would think for Permian Basin, what they need to either do right now is commit to something to dive onto the snipers and support them with maybe like a Zarya or something else. But yeah, you're not really going to get too far if you're just going to be picked off before you can even get to the payload for contest.
Yeah, it's. I think the Reinhardt is generally a good pick, but I don't know, in this particular comp, I think they would probably do better with the Winston Zarya combo just to, you know, like you said, dive the snipers, try to make a move, try to, you know, pressure them a little bit.
Definitely, and the McCree came up with three kills right there. The Reinhardt dropped his shield or got crowd control of some kind on him to drop his shield and ended up falling to the Deadeye there. And here we go, the sniper still picking off more people with the Hanzo ult coming out right now. Gonna force the Zenyatta ult right now as well.
This is a very interesting push. No healers, no tanks, and they're working. They're basically just forcing things, not even forcing a whole lot out of the defense. They're just overpowering them.
And Diva's coming up right here.
Yeah, Diva's gonna finally switch to something to hop on those snipers, but gonna be quickly de-mech. So much damage is coming out on the side of UT Austin that there's not a whole lot of shields or defense matrixes can do against it. There's just so much frag that you can just throw at that shield that you can keep it up, but it's gonna disintegrate almost immediately.
So very respectable time right there. 3 points with 4 minutes, 14 seconds remaining there. Mind you, they actually probably could have done that closer to 4.5, if not, I don't think 5 would actually have been acceptable or like really possible, but they did push with less than 3 people on the payload for a prolonged period of time, even leaving it. So, you really can't. The only way that they could have made that better for themselves was just not slacking on being on the payload there. That's about it, you got to say.
Yeah, not sitting on the point or not sitting on the payload, just letting it sit there. I mean, I kind of get what they were going for, trying to go and stagger some deaths so that way they have more push, but they didn't get any push since they didn't have anyone on the point. So I'm wondering if they're going to go with any tanks or healers on defense because it looks like they are going to go with the Torbjörn pick, though. Bean is going to go for the Torbjörn, which I always like seeing. I like seeing Torbjörn, don't see him nearly enough. But no tanks, but they are going to go with a single healer as Mercy.
So maybe they're going to be relying just more on raw mechanics right here, trying to outplay people, get the kills and pits a lot faster so that the healing's not going to be as necessary or mandatory from the other side. Hopefully the shields will be able to kind of drag on the fights a little bit, not let anybody get nuked right away. But we'll see how that actually works out for Permian Basin here.
Yeah, let's see, because they have quite a large amount of damage. That Reinhardt shield, as long as they focus it properly, is not going to survive very long. So hopefully the Diva Matrix is able to pick up some of that slack and keep his team safe. But mechanically, so far, I have to give that to UT Austin. And we'll see how Permian Basin does on their own attack, because I am hopeful. See what they do. Hopefully they notice this little trap here. See if they're not caught out by that. Yep. There we go. Ryan Zen get caught out by that. But that's going to already down one of your healers. 5v6 is not going to be good, so they're going to have to wait another 10 seconds in order for that Zen to come back in.
And looks like that UT is keeping them right at the entrance or right at the spawn as well. The turret actually goes down right there, so that's going to be a little bit of DPS lagging right there, but doesn't look like it's really affecting UT Austin whatsoever.
No, it's they're going to lose their Junkrat, but I really don't think that's going to be enough for a push here, especially with the Torbjörn turret and the Bastion just sitting there almost completely uncontested.
And Baby Diva sitting up top right there gets stunned and single headshot by the McCree. And the Bastion setup right here, he's able to play fairly aggressive, it seems like. Looks like they're struggling a little bit with the turret placement as well as Bastion being spread out. It's a bit obnoxious for them to try and take out or focus a single thing here. Diva's in the back line on the Bastion right now.
He's able to take out that Zen again, so they're going to be out too. And a tank. We're able to take out the Widow, but I don't think... Oh. Is it Torbjörn, is he going to get caught out? He is. I was kind of worried there after he got in that trap.
Now his turret is still up.
Yeah, so far, it's definitely a lot more crisp coming out of UT Austin here. Even without the tank, the shield, or any sort of big health pool, just melting those shields, making it so the attack isn't able to defend themselves at all. No one can hide from my sight. Case in point right there, Bastion is able to take out the Reinhardt again.
Definitely. You gotta either commit really hard on the dive here, or find a way that you can rotate the Reinhardt shield with the Diva and then use your corners efficiently. Being able to get around that middle section, the little pillar. Oh, we actually had a rest come out there. And looks like the Junkrat and the Torbjörn picked up 2 kills right there.
I do notice that Tal'Nori, I think that's how you pronounce it, does kind of have Peanut's number here. Peanut's trying to play that Junkrat, but it's not quite able to do it. Tal'Nori is just showing just a bit better. Just a bit more confident in that Junkrat on the defense.
We actually also see UT pushing up in the theater on the side right here. Maybe going to look for a flank with the Deadeye. We'll find out how that'll come out here in just a second. There it is, right from the back. Actually on top of the bus, not able to find too much. Ziva gets him bopped off right there, right in the middle. They actually take him out now. This might be UT Permian Basin's time to go into the point and hopefully contest it.
They certainly do have the numbers advantage here, and they have the ult advantage. You haven't seen much of any ults out of Permian Basin, so I'm wondering if they're just gonna, at this point, they need to hold on to them, but seems like the Torbjorn's just trying to go around back to the challenge. Gonna shut him down immediately.
And actually having the Earthshatter come out on the Bastion right there as well. He ended up falling right away, but Permian Basin did actually grab the point. They got 3 minutes to try and get it to this next portion of the map here. Hopefully they'll be able to get it and give us a little bit more of a show here, but I think that it was more UT throwing right there for the first point, being a little bit overly aggressive rather than Permian Basin actually getting the better of them.
Yeah, I think it was just because as soon as they got a pick, it was 5v6, and then it just turned into a numbers game that they should have won. If they didn't win, that would have been the issue. But so far, they are doing a better job of pushing the point than UT Austin did. They're not stepping off it. They're not wasting time. They're getting some good distance here.
And there's the Mercy in the far back. A little bit earlier, we actually saw the Mercy dive in with her pistol and then just jump back up, unable to be killed. Have a Deadeye coming back out one more time.
That was a very good job by Cutie there to shut down that High Noon from Excellence McCree. But and here's one of the issues with this heavy attack comp is that they don't have nearly as much to stand on the point with, because unless they go in all at once, you know, they're not going to be able to defend. They're just going to melt away.
And I think that Torbjorn's going really hard right here. Full hammer mode. Not able to pick up anything, unfortunately. Look at that. Permian Basin likely going to take this point. Yeah, 2.04 meters right here. Just a slight shove. Oh, we actually have the res coming out. That's a three-man res.
I think at least two. I know, I might have missed the third one, but there's at least a two-man res there. But, and the D.Va's the only one on the point. There were so many damage dealers. She's not going to survive very long.
So actually holding it right here, just a little bit over 2 meters to be able to get to the next point. We'll see if they're actually able to come back around and put a full hold on this.
Yeah, see what they're able to make happen here, because Irk did switch to the Pharah. So that is now something that they're going to have to, they don't really have anything to deal with. Challenge is going to be on the, going to switch to the Soldier to try to counter him, but so far hasn't been able to do it.
And grouping that in with the Zenyatta, you would hope that the 76 would be able to get a couple of key shots in here on the Pharah. But keep in mind, if they group that in with the Pharmacy, Thrill the Mercy, just hover around the back line or just be a big annoyance. I mean, that'll be really hard for Permian Basin to be able to get in here as a full team of sits and be able to combo that together. And as you see there, I mean, Pharah just getting a pick off on the Ana right now.
Yeah, right there was a situation where the Zen is so far not dead, but Zen and Ana both needed to get back to where their team was spawning in, because he had to have known they were going to get staggered if they were up by themselves, but they seemed to just think they weren't going to follow them, which cost them quite a bit of time.
And Permian Basin's got 5 seconds to get onto the point. I really don't think that that's even possible, with the exception they had a Tracer with like 5 blinks right here. It looks like that's going to be the first round, Kingsrow going over to UT Austin. So what'd you think about the first round and how that'll probably lead into the following matches on Ithan Ball?
I'm very interested to see. I'm most likely they're just gonna go with the same thing instead of UT Austin, because it obviously worked for them. They're gonna go attack heavy, especially in Eichenwald, where the choke is, that's probably one of the hardest chokes to get through, just because there's only basically really one entrance. And so they're almost gonna, since it worked, they're gonna have to go the damage heavy to break down any shields, to break down any walls that Permian Basin is gonna try to use. And I don't know, just in terms of mechanics, Austin just looked so much better in terms of overall aim and overall positioning than Permian Basin did, at least this round. I think so. I remember when Permian Basin was on the defense on King's Row, remember, if they were going to have snipers and they were going to have, obviously, the Junkrat, you know, damage heavy, you almost need to switch off that Reinhardt. Yes, they don't have a shield to go against you, but they're also going to melt your shield. But if you go with a Winston Zarya, you can kind of bubble and jump in, especially get the snipers out of, you know, off their perches and that kind of stuff. But Azaria, in my opinion, is kind of like Reinhardt. You most often want to see her just because she is so versatile, so useful.
Sure, definitely. And I do heavily agree with the coordination and having that grouped up, seeing the duo with Azaria, with the Winston, being able to get to the bath line, disrupt the snipers, have them reposition in an unfavorable spot, and hopefully have your team either be able to push into a certain choke or, I mean, be able to just kill them flat out for that. So it looks like that we are going to see the defense from UT here, actually bringing out the Orisa as well. How do you feel about her in the current meta and the way that things are playing out here?
I think she's fine when she's played right. She is a bit too squishy for my taste, but I'm a bit more focused on the fact that they're going six-tuple tank. No healer, no DPS. They're just, you know, they're going all-out tanks for UT Austin, and that's a very interesting choice. And only a single healer out of Permian Basin, that's going to be a Zenyatta. We wouldn't normally see him solo heal, at least not in a situation like this, where, you know, you when you really want to try to win. But so far, it looks like it is going to go in favor of UT Austin, at least in this fight, because they're playing incredibly aggressive, but yeah, they're making it work for them.
It's so crazy to see them push up this far, right outside of their spawn. With the lack of healers, as you mentioned, they're going to have to utilize the health paths as much as possible. So we're going to see a swap here from Pina actually going over to the Reaper, hopefully be able to shred through the shield a lot quicker, also hit through with the Roadhog. We'll see how that plays out for them right here. Diva's up there all alone by herself for the time being. Gets pulled back by the Roadhog. Is in mini form. Gonna have a 1v1 with her mech rival over here. Don't think that's gonna turn out too favorable for her, though.
No, they are able to take out Tchaikovsky on that Roadhog, being the only one that actually has a self, you know, a self-sustained ability. But it's everyone else, like I said, it's their, like I said before, they're kind of split a bit more than I think they should be if they want to have a coordinated attack, which it really hasn't turned into yet. Especially here, because you see Sour Apple going in all by himself. He doesn't have his healers, DPS, other tanks are with him, and he just goes right into an electric room with a Winston and Azaria. You can't expect to survive that.
And looks like the D.Va is actually able to make it all the way in the back right there. She's going to be 2v1 though with an Orisa versus another D.Va. It's more or less just a stall game right here. Winston jumps in right now. Actually has self-destruct, but she falls. That's not going to take anybody out with her.
She's going to pay with her life there. Escott is going to go down, so that is a good pick, taking out that Winston. And a very solid Earth Shatter, taken out too, but doesn't have a whole lot of damage follow through to make it worth anything.
I think right here, this is just showing, be it the coordination or the skill gap or whatever that may be, just how confident that UT is and the fact that they're able to make this work. Still in a Gravital Surge right outside of the spawn, still able to make this go in their favor. I mean, even just staying back in the portion where maybe UT Austin can't pick you off and then you can just get free heals nonstop. Because UT Austin, as you mentioned, still no healers whatsoever. It's very rare to see that a team wouldn't be able to break through even around this little bend right here without being able to swing that in their favor.
Yeah, I think the thing that Permian Basin needs to do is, like I said, target priority, which they are doing now a bit more. They are now going to take out three, and that's definitely going to be good for them. Tchaikovsky is now going to be on the Bastion now that I look at it. But they're able to take out three, four now that Tal'Nori is going to go down on the D.Va, but they're not pushing forward. They're not getting on the... There we go. They're not pushing forward nearly as fast in order to, you know, benefit from that, but looks like they are going to take it. Earth is in the back, all by himself. He's not going to survive very long, but no, they are jumping in. All right. We are going to see a fight on the point.
And right here, Earth Shatter comes out for Permian Basin. I think they're going to be able to clean it up and finally take it through. The D.Va mech is going down right here. Just 1-2 at the swing. She goes down, and yeah, that should be Permian Basin's point now. I was a little bit worried at the very, very beginning there when they weren't getting on the point quick enough, just because of how we've seen UT Austin go through and just do crazy, like, mechanical outplays, that they were going to take that back. But yeah, they made that swing in their favor.
It was a very good job. And that was definitely on the back. That confrontation was definitely on the back of Sour Apple, landing a very nice Earth Shatter, knocking down three. But are they going to be able to hold this? Because you got Winston jumping in and jumping in the back line. There we go. QB's able to take him out. But a nice Earth Shatter from Excellent is able to get knock three of his own down. I mean, the Graviton made it a little easier, but was able to do it.
And so what do you think about this position right here? With UT pushing up, it's a pretty strong, it's a pretty hard place to get into and push through with this little corridor right here as well. Kind of similar to getting through the very, very first choke. How do you think that Permian Basin is going to be able to break through this here?
The only thing that they're going to be able to do is muscle their way through because they don't have healers, so they need to just deal out as much damage as they can. Take out that Reinhardt shield, you know, melt down the Orisa shield. Orisa is now going to be gone, but they really need to take out those shields if they have any hope of pushing this very far.
And I think that's... Sorry.
No, that's fine. Alright, we are just going to... Looks like we're just going to go with a skirmish fight here. Able to get one with that Earth Shatter, but he didn't really focus down the one he was able to hit with it. Earth was just laying down on the payload. Maybe taking a nap? I don't know.
But that's actually coming up really clutch there on the defense, them switching it up. I do appreciate that, seeing that they stuck with the Reinhardt for the prolonged period of time. But we'll see if they're able to counter that with their own divers or whatever that may be from Permian Basin side.
Yeah, and you see now the UT Austin did make some switches, so they now do have two supports. Only one healer, but they did go with a couple supports, so now they're not overly tank heavy. They're just going with a simple triple tank comp here. They're going with a kind of a selfless LG Evil, kind of just incredibly overly aggressive defense. Just keeping them in spawn, staggering out some deaths. Making it almost impossible to get to the point. There's only 30 seconds left.
And there we go, pickoff on the support, actually. So, oh, well, the Reinhardt actually goes down as well. Those long charges can be rewarding, but also very harmful as well. And we just see a very bloody horse scrimmage right now from UT, taking out Permian Basin.
Okay, I was a bit more focused on Cutie, sitting on the Bastion, just sitting on the point, pushing it.
I actually missed that entirely.
Tchaikovsky was able to find him and take him out, but I think Cutie's just sitting there. It's like, this is fun. I guess I'm doing my job. Everyone else can just go and die. That's fine. You're just sitting there.
I think it'll be interesting if that extra distance actually causes UT in the end, but we'll see how it comes out here.
That would be very, very interesting, and I would actually really like to see that, just because like that few extra, you know, maybe I'll say 100 meters, that'll be the difference between a loss and a victory. It'd be very interesting to see.
Yeah, and now that I look back on it, it looks like that they weren't able to make it through that entrance right there where the gate opens up after you get the point. But yeah, now that I'm looking back at where the payload actually went to, they actually made it a fair way, I would argue, a little bit over halfway to the second point there. So yeah, I mean, that's a fairly respectable distance, I'd say, especially on Icon Ball, if you're able to break through the first point here.
Yeah, especially how their attack started, you know, basically trapped in spawn for the longest time. They were able to get some, capture the point, get some distance, which was very, very good. So I'm glad that worked out, because I was so worried that they were going to get full held on, you know, on that first point. So let's see what they're able to do on defense, because they are going to go fairly standard, except they're going to go with a triple support Bastion comp here. So I'm interested to see how that works out for them.
And so what are your thoughts on triple supports? Because you hear mixed things in terms of, well, if we run a Symmetra, then we only need one healer, as long as it's like an Ana or a Lucio for the wide healing or for the strong healing. But people tend to not really favor the Symmetra plus also two supports. So what do you think about that?
Well, this one I think can work, especially with the Zen Sim, because you can get the Zen Discord Orb in there, and then you can... Sim does massive amounts of damage if she's able to stay on you. But my opinion is, as long as you get picks with it, as long as it can work, everything is viable. But the Sim turrets are going to make it a little difficult for the Widow to jump in like that. So interesting to see if they're sticking with that for right now.
And I'm just noticing this now. They're actually running the attack Symmetra right here. So we'll see how that's actually going to work for them. The Reinhardt shield is pushing up fairly far, but it looks like that his shield's getting a bit low. Gets stuffed right there. Gets picked off. So the front line is going to be down there. Mind you, from Permian Basin side on the defense, they do have two shields with the Orisa as well as the Symmetra coming out. And Orisa's actually getting some lock-ons here on the offense.
Yeah, the thing that, as you know, as I said on their defense, the most surprising thing is they're going quadruple support. Sorry, not quadruple support. They're going quintuple support with Widow. So potentially they have a lot of sustain, but the problem with this comp is they're squishy. They have very little, very small health pools. Very little they can do. They're not even paying any attention to Sour Apple.
Now, is he actually going to be able to break through that? I'm pretty sure he can't dish out more DPS than the Transcendence is going to be killing off. He actually gets distorted right there. People flanking him around the side. He hasn't fallen just yet, though.
Looks like they are going to be able to reestablish and defend this. And I think they did barely get two ticks. So if they're able to break through again, they might be able to get it. But they were able to reestablish and pull them off.
Sour Apple right
might get a staggered Symmetra. Yep, there it is. I was waiting for it, waiting to see if they could do it. But we have Urk all alone. Zen v Zen. See who wins.
That she gets taken down right there. Kick right to the face. So we know who the superior Zenyatta is, at least for this time.
Yeah, here clearly Lobo just had the one up on him. Alright, looks like an Ana up all by herself. Sim v Sim. But B is gonna be able to take that fight.
There's actually the Widow in the back right here, trying to push up on the Bastion, make something happen right there. Looks like she gets left as well. We actually see the Bastion going down to the Ana. Comes out a res right here.
Yeah, I think, yeah, that res was one of the things that helped them. It kept their attention up front while the rest of them were able to take that point and just get that one tick needed. Yeah, see, if you could just get a couple very important picks, it was an easy cap.
And here we go. We see UT Austin actually pushing very aggressively back up, gonna keep them as far away from the payload as possible. Only one on the load actually right now, which would be the Zenyatta. Yeah. It looks like Permian Basin's pushing back up right now. Should be able to go and contest this and make this work in their favor.
There we go. They're gonna get on it because they got a whole lot of push and Zen ult out of Urk, I think. That was a bit selfish there, man. Trying to just save yourself like that.
He was just using it to run away a little bit there.
And Scott, I think he's jumped off the edge twice. Is that what I've seen? I think that's what I'm looking at. Alright, it looks like he's back with his team now, but I think I saw him jump off the edge at least once. Then a Reinhardt caught up all by himself, and with a Discord Sim, you know, all around you, there's not a whole lot you can do there. You were dead to rights there.
There was the sound barrier coming out right there. The Widow is in the back line, going full Widow 76 right here. Not able to pick off anybody just yet. There we go. The Symmetra picking up the Ana. Widow 76 picking up the Orisa, and then also the Zenyatta on the back end right here.
And then that is different. That's gonna be it. I don't know if the... Oh, no, they are able to get on it. Just... Oh, no, they didn't get close enough. I was thinking they had the people there. They could have done it, but they're too focused on getting that ult out, I think.
So, very interesting games there. I was enjoying the switch up from the typical meta and seeing what UT was able to throw out right there. I felt that it was very fun myself.
Oh yeah, it was definitely one of the most interesting games I've seen. I mean, I've seen some of that in comp sometimes, but it never works that smooth. I noticed, at least, whenever people try when I'm on their team. So I'm really glad to see it work. I'm just very surprised that it worked.
And so what do you think was actually the key factor there for UT on Icon Ball? What do you think it was the one that actually turned it around in their favor here?